lean to working on one more than the other, and then I get this damaged thing that I need to repair.
Yeah.
You know, if you really look at your brow and are appreciative and step back from it, you don't have to overdo it and ruin the brow line. You're right. It's a natural indication for most people. And then there's, of course, the few that need, you know, extra special help.
Right, where it's just like the unibrow or something
unibrow,
like
that. Unibrow, or they didn't get any brow, you know what I mean? Or
exactly.
Know.
How I was going to ask this, what are the major eyebrow faux pas? I've heard, you know, there's ones like you never tweeze above the eyebrow.
That's old school. That's really wives' tale. We've kind of generated out of that one for a long time now. I think everybody knows it's okay.
It is okay.
I just think it was moms trying to protect their daughters from not ruining their eyebrows. You know what I mean? And they figured that was a great guideline that they could pass on that's going to stop them from torturing them, which women did anyway.
Right, exactly. And about the plucking, how many times should you be plucking a week? Because I'll tell you, Christina, I like should have joined Pluckers Anonymous at one point. I was like in the mirror all the time. I'm like, okay, this isn't working. I need to pluck this. I need to pluck that.
Right.
And by the time my mom saw me when I went home to visit her, and she's like, what did you do to your eyebrows? Oh my God.
Well, no, that's a bad habit. And I always say throw out the magnifying mirror as well. You know, leave your eyebrows to your artists that you trust, your specialists in your, you know, in your community. Because, you know, I have clients, they do not touch their eyebrows. And I know the minute they do. They walk in the door and they've already, you know, the eyebrow walk of shame, you know. So, yeah, they're really regular and they know not to touch them. And if they do, they know the guidelines of where to touch.
What is the guideline, Christina? Because that's what I want to know. Like, where should I never touch my eyebrows? Because I have a problem about going in the inner corners and the outer corners.
Right. Well,
bad
I always
places.
Say you're allowed to do a finger width between your eyebrows. While you're maintaining your eyebrows between your artist's work, you know
mm-hmm.
what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, a finger's width between your eyebrows is pretty, you know, the size, the width of your nose almost, you know?
Okay.
And then I always say stay as far away from the line as possible. So if you see some random hairs that you know are growing outside the line below, you know, on your brow bone,
right?
You know what I mean? You can take those. But the natural brow, when you start going up inside of it, and taking close to the line, that's when people tend to destroy their brows.
Okay.
You know, the old rule is, and it's just the standard thing, and there's variables for everybody in this, but, you know, just make sure your arch starts on the outside corner of your iris, you know, and keep away from the end of the brows. People tend to remove their tails more than anything.
Yeah, that's what I do, and then it looks really odd.
Right? They're like hanging in the air. You know, and then you're going to have to pencil them in, which, you know, you don't necessarily have to do on an everyday basis, but mm-hmm. it really finishes a brow if you add the end of a brow, you know, lengthen it or pull it out or whatever's necessary. You know?
Right. What happens if you over-tweeze and they're not growing back? Because, you know, that old wives' tale, I'm not sure if it's true or not, but sometimes you can actually kill the root of the hair and it won't grow back. What do you do?
Well, they do have products on the market that I think are really good that help encourage hair, you know, but it's mm-hmm. like being diligent. You have to do it every night or else it won't work.
Like,
you know?
Rogaine or something like that?
Yeah, there's a product out there called Billion Dollar Brow. I think it's pretty decent, you know?
Okay.
So, yeah, I think it's a good product. And you can grow it, but then that person has to have due diligence not to touch them in the process.
Right,
you know,
right.
Because eyebrows grow in their own random, you know, pace. They don't grow in a perfect line one row after another.
It took me, like I said, Christina, I messed up my eyebrows and I was told by a makeup artist in New York City, she said, you cannot touch your brows.
Right.
She said for like 4 weeks, and it actually took me 6 weeks
right.
before they grew out. And I hated it, but I just, how can you conceal those stray hairs in the meantime? Because they're, you know, they're not pretty, but
right.
you need them to fill out the eyebrow. How can you do that while you're waiting?
Well, we have a really good product that I give, you know, sell to my clients. It's called the Magic Pencil. And
mm-hmm.
it's an opaque concealer highlighter pencil. And you lay that over the hairs under the brow line, which what it does is it opens the eye because you're highlighting the eyebrow
mm-hmm.
and giving it distinction and showing off its shape without having to fill in the brow itself. And then you're adding light to your cheekbone. And then at the same time, since it's an opaque consistency, it will help cover the hairs. And you can lay a little neutral powder or face powder on top of that, and then it will help cover them. It won't mask them completely, but naturally, so, you know, you can go in public and feel confident.
Right. No, that's definitely the important thing. Eyebrows go through trends as well, and I've been reading that the Brooke Shields eyebrow is back. It's no more of the sculpted eyebrow. It's
right.
about being bushy.
Well, yeah, and it looks great. I mean, I wouldn't necessarily put it on one of my executives at, you know, a television station or something. But I think that there's a market for that. You know, some people look better to have a more tailored brow. It just serves their face. But, you know, it's a trend, and it's always a good one to have a full brow, because at least you'll have a good brow for a longer time in your life. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Right?
We are joined right now with Christina Romeo, owner and creative director of Polaris Cosmetics. She's a makeup artist and amazing eyebrow specialist.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask you, too, about some of the trends and colors for the spring and summer that we're going to be seeing, especially from your line.
Mm-hmm. Well, what I love is the lipsticks I developed and the lip glosses that complement it for this season. I have this new lipstick. It's Hyper. It's like it's right in between a coral and a peach, so it really goes for both skin tones.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got a nice creamy consistency. There is no, it's not matte where it dries your lips out, and it's not too creamy where you're greasy. It's just the perfect texture where it like nourishes your lip and gives you the perfect color. And then I have these glosses that go on top that is just amazing.
Oh, yeah, I have them. I have the lipstick and the glosses, and they're like high impact shine.
Thank you.
No, they're really good, and they are like fun, flirty colors.
Right, and they're not sticky, which I really love, because people hate sticky lip glosses.
Oh, yeah, I hate it. Like I stopped wearing lip gloss for a while, because I have full lips naturally. I'm not like Angelina Jolie or anything, but when I would put the gloss on, I looked like a fish, because some of them were just so sparkly, and it was just like too much.
Uh-huh.
And then my hair would just stick anytime the wind would blow. And guys don't want to kiss that.
No, they do not want to kiss that.
Yeah, so I like that yours are like non-sticky.
Well, it's interesting. We do take men into consideration in our makeup line. Not, you know, where they guide it. I mean, it's all women-based company.
Right.
But it's just that they have an influence where, you know, I listen to the husbands and the boyfriends, you know, when they say, oh, I don't want to have that sticky feeling on my lips, you know?
Yeah.
But they love the look of a little shine on the woman's lip. You know, they find that seductive.
Should you be putting the gloss all over the mouth, Christina, or should it just be like I've heard, oh, only in the Cupid's bow, only in the main pout? I mean, what's the trick to fuller lips? Because I've been hearing so many controversial things about this.
Well, it's light. You know, if you're using the glosses to reflect light, or if it has a little, you know, sort of a lighter color in it, you're going to put it where you want the lip to pop out. Because light, you know, reflects, you know, the lighter color reflects the light, which makes your lip look fuller or bigger. Wherever you place it. So you're right. It depends on the person's lip. If you have a small top lip, I'd probably concentrate in the Cupid's bow.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a smaller bottom lip, I would do that, you know. But most women want full lips right now, so you'd probably be doing both anyway.
Right, right. The fuller, the better.
Right.
What about the lip plumping things that are on the market now? Do you think there are like a bunch of baloney?
Well, I mean, I have some lip plumping items. I think it's the sensation more than the actual fact. Do you know what I mean?
Okay.
I think it gives you a sensation. I mean, I've seen some that actually cause almost like a slight irritation to the lips that cause them to plump.
That's not good.
No, but, you know, hey, you know, it makes you feel better that you feel your lips are fuller. That's part of beauty, too. It's the psychology. You know, it's planting the positive seeds.
Right, exactly.
Exactly.
And in terms of, I was just going to ask this, someone told me to put a highlighter in the Cupid's bow, like just white sparkly stuff in the Cupid's bow. Does that look weird?
No. If I use it with the magic pencil, it's a flat, so it's a, you know, there's a warmer side for, you know, more ethnic skin tones, mm-hmm. and the lighter side, or both, doesn't matter, you know, but you can use that underneath. I use the highlighter stick for a lot of things, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Definitely. It has a lot of good, like you can take the highlighter stick if you've lined your eyes and put your mascara on, and you can just take it right above your lash line,
mm-hmm.
and it adds this just little hint of lift to your eyes. It's so natural and subtle that people just look at you, wow, you look really good. One of those.
Right. So it's good if you haven't slept.
Exactly. So I highly, highly recommend our magic pencil for anybody. Anybody can use it. It's fabulous.
I love that. And with the shimmer, too, I know a lot of women are loving the shimmer, but that shouldn't be applied all over the face, right? We don't want to look like we're vampires in the sun like in Twilight.
Well, I think like 13-year-olds would.
Yeah, well, that, yeah.
What's in right now for them.
Exactly.
Exactly. No, I don't think that's the best thing. You know, and I think you have a really good sense of what's going on in makeup as well. I want to say that about you.
Oh, thanks. Well, it helps. It helps to be able to get to use Polaris Cosmetics all the time. And anyone can, too, if they go to PolarisCosmetics.com. Christina, you have been so informative. I hope that you'll join us again here on Cosmalicious.
Oh, it would be my pleasure. And it was a pleasure talking to you.
And by the way, I don't think you're any kind of quiet, innocent woman.
Oh, dear.
Thank you. Enjoy the sunny weather in California.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay, I'm feeling all kinds of quiet innocence, though.